The Tafsir of Suratul Al-Anbiya by Sheikh Abdul Nasir Jangda. The following video was recorded at Quran Intensive, Bayana's summer program. For more information, visit bayanasummer.com. This video was filmed and produced by Salam Studios and is brought to you by muslimmatters.org.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قال ربي يعلم القول في السماء والأرض وهو السميع العليم بل قالوا أضغاث أحلام بل افتراه بل هو شاعر فليأتنا بآية كما أرسل الأولون ما آمنت قبلهم من قرية أهلكناها أفهم يؤمنون وما أرسلنا قبلك إلا رجالا نوحي إليهم فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون وما جعلناهم جسدا لا يأكلون الطعام وما كانوا خالدين ثم صدقناهم الوعد فأنجيناهم ومن نشاء وأهلكنا المسرفين لقد أنزلنا إليكم كتابا فيه ذكركم أفلا تعقلون الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. So in the previous session we covered ayahs through to 4. 2, 3 and 4 where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the condition, the spiritual condition of these people and talks about what they preoccupy themselves with when the message is delivered to them. When they come across the message, they come across the reminder from Allah. What they engage in, the type of behavior that they engage in. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 4 told us about the response of the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the things that I wanted to point out that I was not able to in the previous session was we talked a lot about the response of the messenger. Look at the tone of it. Look how he constructed it. And also the fact that even the response of the messenger was evidence of the fact that he is in fact a messenger of God. He does in fact receive divine revelation because Allah is telling us, وَأَسَرُّوا النَّجْوَى. They are very quietly, secretly whispering to one another. And in spite of that, and they know that. And then the messenger basically comes to them and says, my Lord knows everything that you've said. And in spite of that, I keep doing what I'm doing. So they're so taken aback by the fact that how does Muhammad even know what we talked about? And so it's very miraculous, it's very powerful. But I told you in the intro of the surah, the introduction to the surah, that the surah will not just simply tell us about Anbiya. You know, something I constantly remind students whenever I get the opportunity to teach them tafsir, especially those portions of the Qur'an that include stories. I always try to remind them that the Qur'an uses stories. The Qur'an contains stories, but the Qur'an is not a storybook. And there's a very, very subtle yet profound difference between the two. A storybook, the objective is to tell the story. And so it begins and ends with the story. It focuses on the story, and that's the sole objective. Everything else is on the periphery. Everything else is a side benefit. The Qur'an, however, is a book of guidance. The Qur'an delivers guidance. It uses stories in order to teach lessons and deliver that guidance and make that guidance palatable. However, the focus is guidance. And that's very, very important to remember. So the fact that this is Suratul Anbiya, the surah about the prophets, that doesn't just simply mean it's going to tell us a bunch of stories about a bunch of prophets. But rather, the purpose of that is to not only for us to find inspiration, for us to find strength, for us to feel a sense of belonging by reading about, by learning about, by listening to, and being able to relate to these prophets and their experiences that are so much more overwhelming and powerful than maybe an experience we've had. But on top of that, beyond that, there's something else here. There's something else here. We have to understand our, and this is something we'll talk about more. This will be a focus. This is a theme that is focused on at the end of Surah Al-Anbiya, where Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is being addressed. We will talk about it there, but we can't afford to not at least talk about it and keep it in mind from now. And that is, as the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have a huge responsibility in order to carry on, to deliver, to continue the message, the work of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَىٰ بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was commanded by Allah to announce, proclaim, this is my path. I invite anyone and everyone, all of humanity, to Allah alone. And I do so with conviction and knowledge and profound understanding. And that is my responsibility, my station, my mission, and anyone who claims to follow me. So we have that same responsibility that has been deputed to us. But what we have to understand is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to guide us on how to go about this responsibility properly and appropriately, how to conduct ourselves, da'wah. Da'wah is a buzzword in the Muslim community. We all talk about da'wah. We all want to do da'wah. We all understand da'wah is very important. But have we taken the time to sit down and really learn and understand from the Book of Allah, from the messengers of Allah, the ultimate da'is of all time? Have we actually learned how to do da'wah? And that's what we need to do. And that's what this surah is teaching us. So when you read the response of the messenger, note something. We're going to read more of what their response is. This is something that is commonly presented throughout the Quran. But what are they already doing? They're already slandering him. هَلْ هَذَا إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Okay, fine, he is a human being. أَفَتَأْتُونَ سِحْرًا. They're slandering him. They call him a magician. And the Prophet ﷺ comes to know of the fact that they sit around behind closed doors talking about how he's a magician. How he's just out to possess people, to conduct, you know, sorcery on people. That's a terrible slander. But what does the Prophet ﷺ do in his response? How does he respond? رَبِّي يَعْلَمُ الْقَوْلَ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Look at the dignity in the response. It's powerful, it's strong, it shows confidence, it shows conviction, no doubt. And we all need to learn to be very confident. In the face of slander, in the face of aggression, in the face of attacks upon what we believe, what we stand for, what we believe in, which is our identity, we need to learn to be confident. We can't be shaken up. But at the same time, one thing that we need to do is we also at the same time need to understand and we need to realize that we cannot stoop down to the level of those who confront us or attack us. Because we do actually stand for something. And we stand for something very profound, very great, very dignified, very noble. And we have to be careful about that. رَبِّي يَعْلَمُ. He surrenders the matter to Allah. My Lord and my Master knows everything that is being said in the heavens and the earth. What you say and what I will say. And that's why I respond to you the way that I do. I won't stoop to your level. رَبِّي يَعْلَمُ الْقَوْلَ فِي السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Now in ayah number 5, they retort back. They answer back. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in ayah number 5, بَلْ قَالُوا أَضْغَاثُ أَحْلَامٍ. So they say three things about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They say three things about the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What are the three things that they accuse him of, that they say about him? Number one, بَلْ قَالُوا, rather they said. Allah says, بَلْ, rather. Meaning instead of listening to what was being said, instead of heeding the message, instead of understanding, dialoguing, contemplating, pondering, they snap right back. بَلْ, rather, قَالُوا, they just said. Without thinking twice about what was going on. أَضْغَاثُ أَحْلَامُ. أضغاث أحلام. أضغاث in the Arabic language is the plural of the word ذغثون. It's a very heavy word to pronounce. And that kind of is indicative of even the meaning of the word. It appears other places in the Quran. Dhighth in the Arabic language means that when you take a bunch of different, like grass and branches, and you know, you take a bunch of random, like what we would almost call like debris. You know, when you mow your lawn, and then all the grass after you've mowed your lawn, all the grass and weeds and everything that's just kind of sitting off to the side, that's dhighth. It's all just like messed up. It's jumbled up. And it even in some usages in the Arabic language, it even refers to like mud. It basically means when everything is just like completely jumbled up and muddied up, like messy, like debris. Adghath is a plural of that. So it means all jumbled and muddied and messy and just a bunch of random things kind of just tied together. Like a bag full of garbage. Ahlamin refers to dreams. Hulm, it refers to dreams, what people see in their sleep. And even the word hulm itself, ru'ya, is something that has some type of meaning or purpose. Hulm itself, ahlam itself, is used for dreams that are meaningless. Like something you see after eating a burrito at 2 a.m. Right? Just meaningless. And it's also actually, it's also used for maybe even dreams that might be inappropriate in nature. The same word is used. So, adghathu ahlamin is like a construction. It's an expression in the Arabic language that means just complete randomness, just complete nonsense. To just see randomness, to see nonsense in one's dreams. So the fact that the Prophet ﷺ recites the Qur'an to them, gives them da'wah, gives them the message, tell them stories of the past. They said, adghathu ahlam. Poor guy, he has these random, crazy, wild, you know, dreams. And then he just comes to us and tells us his crazy, terrible dreams. So that's the first thing they say about the Prophet ﷺ. Number two. Bal iftarahu. Then they say, rather, wait a second. So I want you to pick this up in the tone. They say, bal qalu, they said, adghathu ahlam. He just has these random crazy dreams, meaningless, just randomness in his head. Bal, rather, iftarahu. Oh no, wait. He just comes up with it. These are just lies. These are things that he just makes up on the fly. Bal, rather, huwa sha'irun. He's a poet. Because when they say he has these random crazy dreams, somebody responds to them and says, but it's not so random and crazy. He talks about real life. He talks about real life. Like, look at the Quran, what the Quran addresses, what the Quran talks about. He talks about real stuff. It doesn't sound like the ramblings of a crazy person. It doesn't sound like somebody telling you their burrito-induced dream. So somebody objected to this slander of theirs. So they said, bal iftarahu. No. He just kind of comes up with it on the spot. He pays attention to whatever's going on with people and then he just makes his stuff up on the fly. So then again somebody retorts and says, but wait a second. It can't be something he just comes up with on the fly. It's actually very profound and very eloquent and very powerful and very deep and very structured. Like, nobody can come up with this on the fly. So they say, bal huwa sha'ir. Rather, he's a poet. He spends all day just kind of constructing and writing this stuff up. So what you can see already from even their retort and their response is that they're not confident in what they're saying. They're grasping at straws. They're trying to find anything, something, anything that they can say. And that's why they have three different responses to the same answer that was given to them. And when they give their response, not even the Prophet ﷺ doesn't even have to, but other people are saying, wait a second, what you're saying doesn't make sense. Okay, he makes it up on the fly. No, that doesn't make sense either. Okay, he's a poet. Well, that still doesn't make sense. So what do they say? فَلْيَأْتِنَا بِآيَةٍ فَلْيَأْتِنَا بِآيَةٍ So let him bring to us a sign. A miraculous sign, a powerful, undeniable, irrefutable, immutable, powerful sign. Let him bring something like that to us. Something miraculous. كما أرسل الأولون. Just like the earlier ones had been sent. Just like the earlier ones had been sent with. كما أرسل الأولون بالآيات. Just like the earlier ones had been sent with miraculous signs. So there's two things we have here. Number one, they're saying that this message of the Prophet ﷺ is baffling them. This Quran is just leaving them speechless. So what do? They default to just asking, wanting what you don't have. And they say, okay, we've heard about other prophets and messengers, people that came before him, men who came before him with a message. And apparently they had these miraculous, powerful things. Musa alayhi salam's staff becomes a snake. Isa alayhi salam is curing the blind and the leper. So let him bring to us something miraculous like that. What they don't understand is by saying that, they've already indicted themselves. Because at some subtle level, they have accepted the fact that there were messengers and prophets that were sent. So what is Muhammad except the following in that succession of those messengers and prophets? The fact that they have defaulted to this line of argument shows that they've already given in to the initial premise in terms of not believing that there are prophets, not believing that there is one God, not accepting that there is divine inspiration and divine revelation and a divine purpose here. They already just gave in to that. كَمَا أُرْسِلَ الْأَوَّلُونَ. And so you see them grasping and panicking and freaking out here. What happens is when you get backed into a corner and you run out of arguments, and you still keep running your mouth, that's usually when you say something that becomes a proof against you. That's usually when you shoot yourself in the foot. And that's exactly what they've done here. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they're asking for a sign. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 6, مَا آمَنَتْ قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا أَفَهُمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَا أَمَنَتْ قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا. Never ever did we destroy a single town. مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ مِنْ لِتَبْعِيدٍ. Never ever did we destroy even a single town, a single village that had believed before them. Before them, we have never ever destroyed even a single town or a single village that actually believed. Meaning what? It's a very eloquent, powerful way of saying what? That only those before them have been destroyed who did not believe. Those who believed were not destroyed. أَفَهُمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this to make them realize that no. The ball's in your court. The ball's in your court. We've given you more than enough proof, more than enough evidence, more than enough reason for you to believe. The ball's in your court. Don't try to flip this around. Don't flip the tables. The ball is in your court. And you need to think about the consequences of your choices. You've been given a message. Now if you believe and accept this message, you'll be safe. If you don't believe and accept this message, then look back at the people that passed before you that did not believe and what happened to them. أَفَهُمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now will they actually believe? And there's a very profound thing here that the scholars explain. The scholars explain that one of the things is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the sunnah of Allah, is that whenever a nation would demand, whenever a people, a nation that a prophet, a messenger was sent to. First of all, a prophet and a messenger being sent to people is a blessing, but is also a huge responsibility. Because if you now deny, refuse, reject this prophet, this messenger, you're asking for trouble. Number two, when a messenger and a prophet is sent to a people, and they demand, they ask for some specific proof and evidence, and that is given to them, that's it. That seals the deal. And they still don't believe? Look at the nations that came before us. Ad and Thamud. They demanded, they asked. Thamud asked Salih for the naqa, for the she camel. They were given what they asked for. And what happened with them? We know what happened with them. They were annihilated. They were destroyed, wiped off the face of the earth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here that they are asking for trouble. And it is from the mercy of Allah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wanting to give them some more time. So He's not giving them exactly what they ask for. Secondly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Isra, Surah number 17, ayah number 59, وَمَا مَنَعَنَا أَن نُرْسِلَ بِالْآيَاتِ إِلَّا أَن كَذَّبَ بِهَا الْأَوَّلُونَ. That nothing prevented us, Allah says, nothing prevented us from sending signs, miraculous signs with messengers, except the fact that all these miraculous signs had already been sent with previous messengers and they were still rejected. The earlier people still rejected them and denied them and did not believe in them. وَآتَيْنَا ثَمُودَ نَاقَةَ مُبِصِرَةً. We gave Thamud the she camel that they asked for. مُبِصِرَةً, clearly, evidently, without a doubt. فَظَلَمُوا بِهَا, but they did wrong by it. They did wrong by this miracle that was granted them. وَمَا نُرْسِلُ بِالْآيَاتِ إِلَّا تَخْوِيفًا. And that's exactly what Allah says. We do not send signs except as a warning. Meaning what? When that sign that you are demanding and asking for, when it does come, know that you're at the end of the road. There's no more journey left beyond this. It's do or die. That's it. Make your bed now. Choose one or the other. It's time to decide your fate. وَمَا نُرْسِلُ بِالْآيَاتِ لَا تَخْوِيفًا. And on top of that, the scholars explain that somebody, this was also to basically keep them honest, that someone who could not appreciate, understand, and even be convinced to believe because of the miracle of the Qur'an, the rationale of the Book of Allah, the intellectual depth of the Qur'an, the emotional arguments that the Qur'an makes, this powerful, overwhelming spirituality of the Book of Allah, somebody who could not be convinced to believe because of this, that person never ever would believe just because something out of the ordinary occurred. That's what they wanted. They wanted to be razzled and dazzled. That's what they wanted. They wanted something like very out of the ordinary to occur. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, no. This is enough. This is it. And I'll tell you one thing. I'll tell you one thing about us today. Myself, us, as a community, as Muslims today. We have a little bit of the same problem when it comes to the Book of Allah. We are so desperately sometimes waiting for, clinging to, some type of extraordinary supernatural occurrence or some out-of-body experience in order to convince us of the fact that there is Allah, that we worship Allah, that we are on the truth and that we are right, we are correct, we're doing what's right. We are so desperately waiting for some profound, out-of-body, metaphysical experience. And we have to understand one thing. We could have the most unbelievable, phenomenal, supernatural experience that any human being has ever had. But if this Qur'an, this Book of Allah, this Kalam of Allah was not enough to change our lives, to have an impact on us, to convince us of the truth, then that out-of-body experience won't do anything for us but just make an interesting Facebook post. That's all it'll be. That's all it'll be. So we have, remember what we said yesterday, what Ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhumah told us. تَقْرَؤُونَهُ مَحْضًا لَمْ يَشِبْ. You read this Qur'an with sincerity, with integrity, with honesty. You approach it every single time. You pick it up and you open it with that sincerity, that open mind, open heart. And it'll never get old. It'll never be a dull experience. هُوَ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هُدًى وَشِفَى. هُدًى وَرَحْمَةً لِقَوْمِ يُؤْمِنُونَ. People who approach the Book of Allah with an open mind and open heart, eager to learn, to grow, to benefit, the Qur'an never disappoints. It is mercy and it is guidance. It is a cure. It is an unbelievable, the most unbelievable experience. مَا آمَنَتْ قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَهَا أَفَهُمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Ayah number 7, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now further responds to them. This is something very interesting. So far, what did we have? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you know, basically, reprimanded them, and they responded back, هَلْ هَذَا إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Then a second response was given to them, or they were responded to. Then they responded back. Then they were given a response. Now instead of them responding back in ayah number 7, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues talking to them, continues refuting them. And what's very interesting is that even in dialogue and discourse, when one party says responds, gives a refutation and gives a response, and then keeps on going, that actually shows that the other side has been defeated. That shows how preposterous, how ridiculous what they had to say was, that now you just pile on. You don't pull the foot off the pedal, you keep going. You keep knocking down those threes. You punch it in for another touchdown. They don't like it, they can go cry later. But you keep going, you keep pushing hard. And so that's what happens. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in ayah number 7, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ O Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah, Ya Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا We had never sent before you except men, إِلَّا رِجَالًا, except for men. Meaning every single prophet and messenger that came before you were men. Meaning they object to the fact that you are just a man. Well, they were all men. And they already accepted the back. كَمَا أُرْسِلَ الْأَوَلُونَ They've already accepted the fact that there were messengers that were sent before you. So tell them they were all men. They were all human beings. They were all men. By the way, this ayah is also the clear proof and evidence of the vast overwhelming majority of the position of the scholars of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that prophets and messengers were all from the men. That it's a very, very small minority opinion that Nubuwah was bestowed upon a few women. But that is an extremely small minority opinion, not the position of the majority. That's an aqidah discussion, but I just wanted to allude to that because this ayah is an evidence of that fact. They were very blessed women. They were amazing women, remarkable women. But we're talking about nubuwa specifically. All right? وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ They were men, but there was something unique about these men. نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ We used to divinely inspire to them. We used to send divine revelation to them. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ فَاسْأَلُوا So go ask. Go ask. They're being commanded. This is the command form. فِعْلُ الْأَمْرِ Go and ask. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ Ask who? The people of remembrance. The people of remembrance. إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ If you don't know what you're talking about. If you don't know what you're talking about, which you obviously don't, because you've been kind of quiet here for a little while, it's been awfully silent on the other side of this table. So go ask the people of remembrance. Now there's multiple things that we have to understand here. First and foremost, I want to point out something in the balagha, the linguistics of these ayat. So far, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He was refuting them, He was saying, مَا آمَنَتْ قَبْلَهُمْ مِنْ قَرْيَةٍ أَهْلَكْنَاهَا أَفَهُمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ Allah was talking about these people who are arguing, criticizing, slandering, talking bad about the messenger. Allah was refuting them and talking about them in the third person. He was talking to the Prophet ﷺ about them in the third person. And this is done tawbihan. This is done taqbihan, tawbihan. This is done out of disgust. These people are so pathetic. These people are so sad that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says they are not even worthy of being addressed directly. So I will talk to the messenger about these people. They don't even deserve to be spoken to. I'm so disappointed with you right now. I can't even look at you. When a parent, when a teacher, when somebody says that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not even addressing them. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا He's still talking to the Prophet ﷺ. But then at the end of this ayah, Allah turns to them and directly addresses them. فَاسْأَلُوا So why don't y'all go and ask? Why don't y'all go and ask? He turns to them and directly commands them. This is in fact, also this nuance, this rhetorical function in the Qur'an or in the Arabic language is in fact called iltifat. To transition, to turn, to change from third person now to second person, to address them directly. So the scholars even point out, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala address them directly when He was not addressing them earlier? Because like I said earlier, Allah was stating the facts. And they were behaving so terribly, they were being so unreasonable that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wasn't even directly addressing them. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does directly address them and tell them to go and ask others. Why? To put them on the spot. To expose them and their ignorance. That you keep sitting here making these ignorant arguments, baseless arguments, go ask. Put them on the spot. Go ask. So to expose their ignorance, to put them on the spot, to not leave anywhere for them to turn, to end the conversation, Allah directly addresses them and puts them on the spot. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Go and ask the people of remembrance if you don't know. Now what does that mean? Who are the people of remembrance? So this is going to have multiple layers. This is a multi-layered, you know, this ayah, this is a multi-layered ayah. At multiple benefits for this, at multiple layers. First and foremost, based on the context, the historical context, the flow of the ayat, that these mushrikun, these disbelievers who are criticizing the Prophet ﷺ and objecting to the message, they're being told, go and ask the people of remembrance. And what is meant by the people of remembrance, Mufassirun explain, that what the ones who are referred to as the people of remembrance are the Christians and the Jews, the Ahlul Kitab. They're being called the people of remembrance. Why? Because they received the reminder. Just like Muhammad is trying to deliver the reminder to you, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Prophets came before who delivered the reminder to these people, and they still believe in and hold on to the fact that those prophets were sent. They believe in those prophets. So go and ask them. You don't know what you're talking about. You don't even believe in scripture. You don't believe in prophets and messengers. Go and ask them, and they'll tell you. And by virtue of this fact, the Christians and the Jewish tribes, remember when this is being revealed? This is like ninth year of prophethood, of Nubuwwah. By now the word has spread. Christian and Jewish tribes have come to know about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his message. So now Allah is, by virtue of this, putting them on the spot as well. That come on, you come into this conversation as well. You've kind of sat back and decided to wait this thing out. Don't you believe in prophets and messengers? Don't you believe in divine scripture? And everything that Muhammad stands for, everything that he says, everything that he reads and recites, everything that he preaches and teaches. Don't you find that to be consistent with what Musa and Isa and all the other prophets, alayhimus salam, what they also stood for and taught and preached? So come on, what are you sitting back there waiting for? So by this virtue, by virtue of this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts them on the spot as well. Secondly, there's a historical reason for why Allah is telling the Quraysh to go and ask the Christians and the Jews. You might say, why would Allah tell the Quraysh, the mushrikun, to go ask Ahlul Kitab? Why? For many reasons. The Ahlul Kitab weren't proper believers. They hadn't believed in the Prophet ﷺ yet. You could also argue that what if the mushrikun say, what, ask them? Well, they're just as crazy as you are. Why would I go and ask a bunch of crazy people about a crazy person? They could have responded in this way. But you know why they couldn't? Why it put them on the spot? Because see, the mushrikun, the people of Quraysh, you know what they had done? They had selected people, representatives, and sent them to some of the Jewish and the Christian tribes. They had sent them to the Ahlul Kitab. And they sent them to the Ahlul Kitab, some representatives, to go and discuss with them, talk to them, to consult with them about how to deal with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they said, look, he claims to be a prophet. He says he receives divine revelation. He talks about life after death, hereafter, resurrection, Jannah, Nar, Jahannam. He talks about all this stuff. And apparently so do y'all. So y'all would know a little bit better about how to gauge. Can you give us some questions to ask? Can you tell us some things that we're supposed to look for? What are some things that would be consistent? They had consulted with them, turned to them for advice, for help, for insight. And they thought they were really slick. They thought nobody knew about this. This was really hush-hush. This was like an upper-level decision. And it was for eyes only. Strictly confidential. Highest security level clearance. And they thought they were good. They were keeping this on the DL. And what happens? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just called them out. Oh yeah, you know those Ahlul Kitab that you regularly go and consult with about Muhammad? Why don't you ask them about this? And they're like, yes, last verse as well. Again, they're just like, I don't know what's there. On the spot again. So they're just being just destroyed. They're just getting just obliterated here. فَسَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And then, more tangibly, more specifically, one of their objections was what? هَلْ هَذَا إِلَّا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. They made these same objections. Other places in the Quran, Allah tells us about their objections as well, that they specifically said, وَمَا مَنَعَ النَّاسَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا وَمَا مَنَعَ النَّاسَ أَن يُؤْمِنُوا إِذْ جَاءَهُمُ الْهُدَى إِلَّا أَن قَالُوا أَبَعَثَ اللَّهُ بَشَرًا رَسُولًا. That the only thing that prevented a lot of these people from believing was that guidance came to them, but rather in response to guidance, what did they say instead of accepting it? They said, that did Allah really send us a human being as a messenger? قُلْ لَوْ كَانَ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَلَائِكَةٌ يَمْشُونَ مُطْمَئِنِّينَ لَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَلَكًا رَسُولًا. Tell them that if this entire earth was full of angels, instead of human beings, if there were angels walking around on this earth, then Allah would have sent an angel as a messenger. Because the purpose of a messenger is to be what? A muqtada, a qudwa, uswa. The purpose of sending a messenger is for him to be a role model, a leader. And it is from the requirements of leadership. It is from the requirements of leadership that the leader be from amongst the people. So that he is relatable. So that he is not, you know, he's nobody can claim that he doesn't know what's best for us. Or he doesn't know what we're going through. Or he doesn't know how difficult this is for us. Ultimate leadership is from the same people. So that's why Allah said that. This is irrational for them to say. مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولِ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامُ وَيَمْشِي فِي الْأَسْوَاقِ. What's wrong with this messenger? He eats food and he walks around in the marketplaces. In Surah Al-Furqan, Surah number 25, Ayah 7, they objected to this fact. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is refuting this here and telling them that we would have sent a messenger. We would have sent an angel if y'all were angels, but you're human beings, so we sent a human being. In Surah Al-An'am, Ayah number 9, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ جَعَلْنَاهُ مَلَكًا لَجَعَلْنَاهُ رَجُلًا وَلَلَبَسْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ مَا يَلْبِسُونَ. That even if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an angel originally, we would have made him a man and he would have worn the same type of clothing that they wear, because a messenger has to be relatable. There has to be a human connection there, a relatable connection there. So by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling them to go and ask the Ahlul Kitab about the Prophet ﷺ, Allah is specifically telling them to go ask that whether you believe in Muhammad as a messenger or not, just tell me this much. You do believe in the fact that there were messengers. Those messengers that you believe in, Ibrahim, Ishaq, Ya'qub, Yusuf, Musa, Isa, alayhimu salam, tell me this. Were they human beings or not? Or were they something else? And what's the obvious response? Yes, they were all human beings. They were all human beings. And so again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts them on the spot. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was even told to respond to them. قُلْ مَا كُنْتُ بِدَعًا مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. I'm not some innovation when it comes to the messengers. They were all men, they were all human beings. أَبَشَرٌ يَهْدُونَنَا. They find it so strange that a human being will guide us. But every single messenger that came before them was also a human being who was sent to guide them. So, مَا أَرْسَلْنَا قَبْلَكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. So go and ask them. Go and ask the Ahlul Kitab if you don't know what you're talking about. And they didn't know what they were talking about. And they also, when they were given this challenge, they knew they could not go and ask Ahlul Kitab, because the response that would be given to them would further indict them. would be proof and evidence against them. Not for them, but against them. But I told you that this ayah is multi-layered. The Qur'an itself, this is part of the miracle of the Qur'an. The Qur'an can be talking about a very specific scenario, but there is always deeper, profound wisdom and many, many lessons that we can take from the Book of Allah. This ayah, Ali bin Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhu, used to say, when he would recite this ayah, he would say, "Nahnu ahlu dhikr." We are the people of remembrance, meaning the generation of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, we are ahlu dhikr for the following believers. For the generations of Muslims that will come afterwards. And the scholars of the Ummah, the Mufassireen, are unanimous, have a consensus that this ayah, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ, this is evidence and proof, not just even against non-believers or disbelievers, but this is proof and evidence for believers that any time we don't know about any matter within our religion, we are commanded by Allah, we are obligated, it is mandatory upon us to go and ask the people that do know what they're talking about. This is where we have to understand. And I won't go off on this too much because that's not the primary purpose here. But this is where we have to understand that our deen and our tradition and our ilm and our knowledge and our practice, our amal, is one that is based on knowledge, it's based on understanding, it's based on tradition. And part of humility, part of being sincere and honest in terms of what we know and what we learn and what we want to practice, is knowing our limitations and turning to the people who know better when we approach a matter that we don't have knowledge about. Going to people of knowledge and learning from them and asking them is mandatory. It's a responsibility. It's an obligation. So it works both ways. It's not only to humble us so that we don't delve into matters we don't know, but rather we turn it over, we delegate it to somebody who does know what they're talking about. But at the same time, it's also an obligation from Allah that when you do reach a matter that you do not know, when you do reach a matter that you do not know, it is not just simply enough to say, "I don't know," like we always talk about. It's important to say, "I don't know," but that's not just simply enough. But it also becomes your responsibility to get to know, to ask, to go and learn. You know, the first step of the process is saying, "La adri." You know, famous story of Imam Malik. They came with a list of questions. Most of them he answered, "La adri, la adri, la adri, la adri. I don't know, I don't know, I don't know." They freaked out. They're like, "What are you talking about? You don't know. We've come here from our people." They gave us a list of questions. And they said, "You're going to go to Medina. You're going to meet the alim of Medina, Imam Dar al-Hijrah, Imam Malik. Go and ask him these questions. What are we supposed to go back and tell them? You keep saying, 'I don't know, I don't know, I don't know.' What are we supposed to go back and tell them?" He said, "Qul lahum Malik la yadri." Tell them Malik didn't know. What's so hard about that? I don't see what the complication is. Malik didn't know. Right? So that's the first step. That's something we all have to understand because we are all basic students. We are all basic students, elementary level students. But at the same time, the next step of this understanding, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't just simply say, قُولُوا لَا نَدْرِي. He didn't just say, لَا نَعْلَمْ. Don't just say that. He didn't just tell us that, say, "We don't know. We don't know." But rather Allah said, فَاسْأَلُوا. He said, "Go and ask." So the second step of that, once that first understanding is there, "I do not know, so therefore I will not comment." But the second level of that is, it is now my responsibility, has become an incumbent upon me, to actually go and ask someone, sit with someone, learn. Otherwise, that's great if we're all humble, we all admit to our ignorance, but we might just stay in a perpetual state of ignorance. We'll just become a community of ignorant, humble people. Right? That's not the purpose. The Qur'an, deen, Islam. See, a lot of times we confuse these two things. We have on one side, we have a very cavalier approach and attitude where everyone's a philosopher and everyone can just pretty much tackle anything they want. We know that's irresponsible. None of us are okay with that. But we also have the opposite extreme as well that we have to be careful about. we have to be careful about where we can't just become so restricted. We're like ignorant to something that becomes glorious in and of itself. I don't know. That's great, but when are you actually going to sit down and know something? It's great that you're upfront about the fact that you don't know, but when's the time actually going to come where you're going to get to learn something? So, deen, Islam, Quran, Sunnah, tradition, scholarship, ilm, is there to enlighten us. So the first step is admitting I don't know. The second step is now learn. Fasalu, go ask a question. And that's where Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, is the same one who also said, As-su'alu nisful ilm. Asking a question is half of knowledge itself. That's why the Prophet praised. He praised the women of the Ansar. He praised them. He said that they don't let their haya, their shame, their modesty, their decency get in the way of seeking knowledge. They ask a question when they need to know. So it's very important. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ayah number 8. Let's keep moving on, inshallah. Ayah number 8. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَاهُمْ جَسَدًا لَا يَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامِ وَمَا كَانُوا خَالِدِينَ. Allah says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَاهُمْ, we did not make them. Them, the prophets, the messengers. وَمَا جَعَلْنَاهُمْ جَسَدًا. We didn't just make them physical structures. The word jasad is very interesting. The word jasad is very interesting. The word jasad is a physical structure. It can be used for both living and non-living. It can be used for both living and non-living. And we see that in the Qur'an. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in fact in Surah Taha, Surah number 20, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talks about that calf that Samiri had made, constructed, to misguide the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأَخْرَجَ لَهُمْ عِجَلًا جَسَدًا لَهُ خُوَارٌ. So that calf that was constructed out of gold and silver, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to it as jasadan. That it wasn't an actual calf, living, breathing, but rather what it was a sculpture. Alright? And so jasadan can be used for either or. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا جَعَلْنَاهُمْ جَسَدًا. We did not make prophets and messengers as just these physical structures. لَا يَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامِ, who don't eat food. وَمَا كَانُوا خَالِدِينَ, and nor did we make them to live eternally. To live eternally. Now, one literal grammatical nuance I'm going to point out to you here. It's actually nothing, you know, out of the ordinary. But a beginner student could have this question. The word jasad apparently seems like a singular word. Ajsad is the plural. Jasad is a singular word. But then when Allah talks about the jasad, He says la yakulun, which is jama'. So this is a grammatical nuance of the Arabic language. Jasad is what they call ismul jins. Even though it is a singular word, but it talks about an entire category of things. So that's why there's no grammatical fallacy here. I mentioned this to refute anyone who would want to try to say the Quran is grammatically incoherent. That there's no grammatical fallacy here, but this is an established principle from the grammar of the language, and this is something that can be observed and can be noted going back to even pre-Islamic, pre-Quranic Arabic poetry. This was an established trend in the Arabic language. لَا يَأْكُلُونَ الطَّعَامُ وَمَا كَانُوا خَالِدِينَ. Now they objected to the Prophet's eating food, like I read the ayah, مَا لِهَذَا الرَّسُولُ يَأْكُلُ الطَّعَامُ. What's wrong with this messenger? He eats food. But why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically pinpoint وَمَا كَانُوا خَالِدِينَ, and they do not live for all of eternity forever and ever and ever and ever and ever? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala specifically key in on this point? That's something to think about. So the mufassirun, the scholars, explain that this is something extra. It's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is refuting something even before they come up with the criticism. He's refuting something even before they come up with the criticism. And that is that before they can talk about the fact that when the Prophet ﷺ, whenever the appointed time comes, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتْ, Allah told the Prophet ﷺ, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ. And this is a theme that will come up later. I believe in ayah number 30 something of Suratul Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will talk about this. وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ Ayah number 34. That we did not let any human being before you live for all of eternity. أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ So if you die, you pass away, you think all these other people think they're going to live forever? كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ Rather, each and every single soul will actively taste death. Is actively tasting death. So this is something that You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is refuting before they even argue. Allah had told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتُ You will die. وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ They will also die. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this here so that whenever the appointed time came and based on the timeline we know now, that when these ayat are being revealed 13, 14 years later, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passes away, then some of them will say, ha-ha, see? That's why we didn't believe back then. Because of this. If he was a prophet, he was a messenger divinely sent by Allah, then how is he gone? How is he dead? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers them here now that look. You went to the Ahlul Kitab and you found out that all the prophets and messengers before were also human beings. Guess what? They all used to eat food as well and none of them live forever. So Muhammad will pass away one day. But that will not take away from the fact that he is a prophet and he is a messenger. وَمَا كَانُوا خَالِدِينَ Ayah number 9, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, However, ثُمَّ Once everything is said and done, ثُمَّ لِلتَّرَاخِي So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now has laid out the struggle. There is the prophet, the messenger. There is the message of the prophet and the messenger. There are the followers, the believers. And then there are those who oppose, there are those who deny, there are those who refute and refuse and reject. And this struggle is there. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ayah number 9, He says, ثُمَّ Then after that, once everything is said and done, this will play out amongst the people. There will be two sides that are created. But once everything plays out, what will happen at the end of the day? When you sit back, when everything is said and done, And you sit back, just like we are sitting here 1400 years later, looking back at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, we are looking back now, what do we find? صَدَقَنَاهُمُ الْوَعْدَ صَدَقَنَاهُمُ الْوَعْدَ We fulfilled, we were truthful to them. We fulfilled for them, the messengers, the prophets, الْوَعْدَ The promise that was made to them. We fulfilled the promise that was made to them. And what was the promise that was made to them? That the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come. Nusratullah. That the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will come. That first of all, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will save them from the clutches of this torment and this torture from these people. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help them. And that Allah azza wa jal will annihilate and destroy the opposition. So, ثُمَّ صَدَقْنَاهُمُ الْوَعْدَ We fulfilled, past tense, we fulfilled our promise to them. We fulfilled the promise to them. فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُمْ And we saved them, past tense. We saved the prophets and their followers and the believers. وَمَنْ نَشَاءُ And whomsoever we will. Whomsoever we choose, we will. That's present slash future tense. Allah says we fulfilled, past tense, our promise. We fulfilled to them the promise, past tense. فَأَنْجَيْنَاهُمْ We saved them, the prophets, past tense. وَمَنْ نَشَاءُ And whomsoever we will choose in the future. Present and future tense. وَأَهْلَكْنَا الْمُسْرِفِينَ أَهْلَكْنَا means we destroyed, past tense. Al-Musrifin. Al-Musrifin is those who excessively cross the line. Who so go so far beyond the line, they can't even see the line in their rearview mirror anymore. They just blow right by the line. We have destroyed, past tense, them, those people. Al-Musrifin. Now, I'd like to explain exactly what this is, what this alludes to, what this means, what this points out to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, وَلَقَدْ سَبَقَتْ كَلِمَتُنَا لِعِبَادِنَا الْمُرْسَلِينَ That our decision has already been made, has passed before for our slaves who were sent, who were messengers. إِنَّهُمْ لَهُمُ الْمَنْصُورُونَ That they were helped divinely. وَإِنَّ جُنْدَنَا لَهُمُ الْغَالِبُونَ And that our armies They were, in fact, dominant. In Surah As-Saffat, Surah number 37, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains this. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that the promise is fulfilled for the prophets. They are saved. And the people that will come in the future will also be saved. And the promise will be fulfilled for them in the future. And those who cross the line have been destroyed. This is generally speaking, but even specifically speaking, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, some of the mufassirun and the ulama and the scholars, they say, this is some of the earliest mentions of Fathu Makkah. This is some of the earliest hinting at the conquest of Makkah. But it also has a general benefit because Allah, al-ibratu bi'umum al-lafz, that Allah said it generally, so it has a general benefit. But it is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His benevolence that He left it open-ended. وَمَن نَشَاءُ. That we have to remember the same thing. We have to remember the same thing. If we believe in what's true, and that we are confronted, we are persecuted, but we stick to what we're supposed to do, what we're supposed to believe in. We don't stoop down to that level. We maintain the honor, the dignity that the prophets taught us, and the strength and the conviction and the confidence that the Quran gives us. Allah's promise will be fulfilled to us just like it was for the prophets and the believers before us. Allah will save us just as He saved the people before us. And those who oppose Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they will be taken care of by Allah just as they were in the past. We have to remember this. And then finally, in ayah number 10, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes. This is the conclusion of this first passage. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا فِيهِ ذِكْرُكُمْ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes the argument by saying, لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا. Without a doubt. Lam is for emphasis. Qad is for further emphasis. I always explain to students that qad is the Arabic, classical Arabic equivalent of pounding your fist on the table. When you talk and you pound your fist on the table, the emphasis, لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا, Allah says, without a doubt, we have sent down. إِلَيْكُمْ, that's what's profound, that's what's beautiful. إِلَيْكُمْ, إِلَيْكُمْ means to you, to y'all. He's talking to those same disbelievers. We have sent down to y'all. And that's very profound that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying it was sent to y'all, it was sent with y'all in mind, it was catered to y'all, specifically designed for y'all, so that you would be able to understand. There's no excuse, there's no reason why you don't believe. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا, a book. And the book, كِتَابًا, grammatically speaking, كِتَابًا, proper or common? So disappointed right now. It's like the saddest moment of my life. Proper or common? Whoever said proper, say astaghfirullah now. All right, good, own it. All right? لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا, common. Well, mentioning it in the common is a rhetorical device in the Arabic language. تَنْكِيد لِلْتَعْظِيمِ. It's to make it more greater. It's to make it very vast and open. Why? Because for some the book is guidance. For some the book is mercy. For some, the book is a miracle. For some, the book is a sign. For some, the book is a solution. For some, the book is help. For some, the book is the answer to the question that has tormented them entire lives. So what does the book mean to us? What does this Quran mean to us? We have to ask ourselves here. It's not just presenting this question to the mushrikun. What does the Quran mean to us? Is it a ritual? Is it a formality? Is it a once a year Ramadan type of thing? We have to ask ourselves what the book means to us. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا فِيهِ ذِكْرُكُمْ. What's in this book? Your remembrance. Your mention, your remembrance. This has two meanings. The Mufassirun tell us it has two meanings. Your reminder, which means a reminder for you. مَوْعِذَتَكُمْ. This is a reminder for you. You are being reminded. What? Tell me what you don't understand here. You are being constantly reminded within this book. ذِكْرٍ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ مُحْدَثٍ. New, fresh ways Allah is trying to remind you. But there's a second tafsir for this, and this is mind-blowing. ذِكْرُكُمْ أَيْ شَرْفُكُمْ. That in this book, He has said, Allah is saying, we have sent down to you, to y'all, a book. That in it is a great honor for you. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. It is a great mention for you, of you. It is a great honor bestowed upon you. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what was the situation? What was the situation of the Quraysh, or of Mecca, or of Arabia, of Hijaz, before Islam? They were isolated. Nobody even knew they were there. Nobody cared that they were there. Nobody bothered with them. Nobody cared about them. Nothing. They were irrelevant in the grand scheme of things. The world was almost like a buzz except for them. And then what happened when Islam came, when the Quran came, when the Rasul came? It became the center of the world, didn't it? It became the center of the world. Till today, look around this room right now. Where are we from? Look, just take a survey of this room. Look how many people we have. Different colors, different ethnicities, different languages, different backgrounds, different places where they live and they reside. And we're all gathered together here in Carrollton, Texas, of all places. Not hating on Carrollton, all right? But in Carrollton, Texas, of all places, and what brought us together? Why are we here? Of course, we're here to improve our relationship with Allah and understand the book of Allah. But what are we tangibly doing in order to achieve those goals? Everybody, what do we do for 8 hours a day? We learn Subhanallah. We learn Arabic. You think if the Quran never came, you think? It's amazing, isn't it? It's remarkable. لَقَدْ أَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ كِتَابًا فِيهِ ذِكْرُكُمْ. Allah told him, you don't understand. Allah has honored you. What do you want? Do you want the meaning and purpose of life? Iman, belief, religion, deen? Then take the Quran, it's there. What do you want? You want honor, dignity, fame, fortune? Well, even that the Quran is willing to offer you. It's made you the center of the universe. It's made you the center of the world. But finally there at the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. So don't you think about this? Don't you sit down and actually think about this? Don't you ponder this? That's the only answer, that you don't think about this. Otherwise you would have realized. أَوَلَمْ يَكْفِهِمْ أَنَّا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابَ يُتْلَى عَلَيْهِمْ إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَرَحْمَةً وَذِكْرَى لِقَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ. Allah says, doesn't it suffice for them in Surah Al-Ankabut, Surah number 29, that we have sent down upon them the book that is recited upon them, and that in that book there is divine mercy and there is a powerful reminder for people who are at least willing to believe, open mind, open heart. And in the previous surah, in Surah Taha, and I'll conclude with this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes Surah Taha very powerfully in the same way. وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا يَأْتِينَا بِآيَةٍ مِّن رَبِّهِ. That they object, they say, why doesn't He come to us with a sign, a powerful sign from His Lord? أَوَلَمْ تَأْتِهِمْ بَيِّنَةُ مَا فِي الصُّحُفِ الْأُولَى. Haven't you come to them with clear proofs and evidences that correlate to all the previous scriptures? وَلَوْ أَنَّا أَهْلَكْنَاهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ مِّن قَبْلِهِ. Allah says that if we would have destroyed them with a punishment that came before the Prophet ﷺ came to them, لَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا لَوْلَا أَرْسَلْتَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. Oh our Lord, why didn't you just send us a messenger instead of destroying us? فَنَتَّبِعَ آيَاتِكَ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَن نَذِلَّ وَنَخْسَى. We would have listened, we would have followed, so that we wouldn't have been ruined and humiliated and destroyed today. قُلْ كُلٌّ مُتَرَبِّسٌ فَتَرَبَّصُوا. Allah says, okay, you want to wait this out? Let's wait this out. You wait it out, we'll wait it out as well. فَتَتَعْلَمُونَ مَنْ أَصْحَابُ الصِّرَاطِ السَّوِيِّ وَمَنْ اِهْتَدَى. Very soon you will come to know who was on the correct path and who was really truly guided. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes by making them understand, by presenting the reality of the book of Allah. What a powerful gift, what a powerful blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this is. But it applies, it requires the human being to apply him or herself. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. We got to seriously sit down and logically and properly and maturely think about the message of the Qur'an. And then we'll find the blessings that are embedded within there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the Qur'an a blessing within our lives. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the Qur'an a means of our success in this life and in the hereafter. Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu wa la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.